Welcome everyone to the Inside Java Newscast, where we cover recent developments in the OpenJDK community. I'm Nikolai Parlock, Java developer advocate at Oracle, and I gotta say, I'm a bit frustrated. Making timely content for the start of ramp down phase one is haunting. Over the 2 weeks it took me to script, record, and edit the last video, a few more features got added, from JFR to a new API to a handful of smaller additions to existing ones. One feature got removed, and I might have missed one or two details. Oh, and new deprecations. So we're going to go over all that today. Think of this episode as What's Happening? Part 2, The Other Side. Ready? Then let's dive right in. The Threat Local API is used to store threat-specific information, usually in static final fields, which can then be queried from anywhere that variable is visible. That's useful, for example, when a container, like a web server, needs to make information accessible to other parts of its code that it doesn't call directly, but it doesn't want to pass that information on explicitly, either for convenience or integrity reasons. But Threat Local has a few shortcomings. First, anyone with access to the Threat Local field can not only read its value, but also set a new one. And second, values stored in Threat Local can be inherited from one thread to another. In order to prevent the other threads from reading an updated value, which the API should explicitly prevent, it's thread local after all, the inheriting thread must create copies. These drive up memory use, especially when there are many threads, you know, the whole millions of virtual threads thing. And third, once set, values must be explicitly removed using the thread local remove method, or they will leak beyond their intended use and continue to occupy memory. To solve these problems, Java 20 incubated and Java 21 previews the scoped values API, which works by binding a value to the scope value instance and passing the code that is allowed to read the value as a lambda, that's the scope. It addresses the thread local issues. First, within the scope, the bound value is immutable. Second, accordingly, no copies need to be created when inheriting, which significantly improves scalability. And third, as the name implies, a scoped value is only visible within the defined scope. After that, the value is automatically removed and so cannot accidentally leak. To see scoped values in practice, watch JepCafe number 16. In it, José talks about the version of the API as it was in JDK 20, but all that changes in 21, besides moving to Java lang, is the scope, the lambda can now be a callable, runnable, and supplier. So 2 weeks ago was June 8th, the beginning of ramp down phase one, when all JEPs that target JDK release are locked in. 2 hours before the newscast goes live, news reaches me that 18 hours earlier, Roman Kenke, owner of the generational Shenandoah JEP, proposed to drop it from JDK 21. I hope you forgive me that I decided against recording a correction and then editing, rendering, uploading, and configuring the video in favor of catching my plane home. Although, now that I say it out loud, I should have made the correction and charged Oracle for another week of holidays. Well, that ship has sailed, unlike the generator Shenandoah one. On the issue, Roman wrote, "The Shenandoah team has decided to skip JDK 21 and take the time to deliver the best generation Shenandoah that we can. 6 month release cadence for the win. JDK 22 is basically around the corner, and I hope we see generational Shenandoah then." Do you know the Diffie-Hellman key exchange algorithm? If you don't, you should definitely look into it. On the face of it, it sounds impossible. It lets two parties compute an encryption key, a number, while an observer that sees every exchanged message cannot feasibly redo the computation. So that key is a secret that only the two parties know. As you can imagine, that's very helpful when you need to exchange encrypted information between parties that have no prior knowledge of each other. Diffie-Hellman is hence widely used, for example, to provide forward secrecy in TLS. Diffie-Hellman can be understood as an instance of a key encapsulation mechanism. Such mechanisms are a building block of hybrid public key encryption and will be an important tool for defending against quantum attacks. Starting with JDK 21, Java has an API to represent key encapsulation mechanisms in a natural way. Now you're wondering what that looks like. Shouldn't I go into explaining that? But that stuff is just too complicated for me. But I don't have the time in this episode, and so I asked Anna to record a newscast on this topic. Probably in August, better subscribe so you don't miss it. Integrity of the Java platform is a very interesting topic. It's not flashy like new language features or APIs or tools, but it is very deep and essential for use of Java. We enjoy many invariants, from the initial value of variables to type safety, from array range checks to no use after free. And integrity guarantees that these invariants are actually invariant, that no code can undermine them. This helps with correctness, maintainability, security, and performance. But Java offers a few ways for code to undermine these guarantees, intentionally or inadvertently.
But anyway, we have this deep reflection in Java, and it means that we cannot trust anything. You try to establish an invariant, but you're back to C. The only way you can know if it holds or not is if you analyze the entire code base and all of your dependencies, and it is violated, even accidentally, even though everyone is well-meaning, no one here is malicious, your invariants do get broken. Now, in the big shift toward allowing you to establish integrity invariants in Java was the addition of modules in JDK 9. And the idea was that a module is an encapsulated unit that is strongly encapsulated. So it prevents that accessible unless you explicitly allow it. So with modules, you say, okay, now I can trust. Now I can establish integrity invariants in Java. And now my encapsulation works. Only there are ways to circumvent it. You could have an ordinary library, again, a dependency of a dependency of a dependency, and it does happen. We did a corpus search. We need to stop it because it happens. It loads an agent dynamically, which means that the application owner does not know it does that. And that agent, what it can do is that is authorized method that does the authorization check. It changes it to always return true.
Yeah.
Any library on your class path can change the meaning of any other line of code in your program without you knowing it due to dynamically loaded agents, not statically loaded agents. Statically loaded agents are fine because the application owner says, I'm allowing this agent to work. I know I take the risk. Two others are unsafe, which I will gradually go away, and JNI. So if you use JNI, JNI is not subject to any of the access checks. So what we will need to do is to say, on the command line, we'll say, I'm going to allow these modules to use JNI.
That was from a conversation with Ron Pressler about this topic that we had during the 28 hours live stream. It was really interesting and we went quite deep. We'll probably upload that in the coming weeks. So what you heard there is that modules can guarantee platform integrity, but are undermined by three mechanisms: unsafe, agents, and native code, JNI and FFM. Over the coming years, unsafe will go away, and the other two will have to be allowed explicitly by the application owner via command line flex. For agents, that is already the case for those launched statically in tandem with the application, but dynamic attachment at runtime can still happen without you knowing. In a first step to fix that, and that brings us back to this episode's topic, JDK 21 will issue a warning when an agent is attached at runtime. In the future, this will very likely not be possible without setting a command line flag. The JDK Flight Recorder is an amazing piece of tech, and it's getting better with every JDK release. 21 added the view command that displays aggregated event data on the terminal. This way, you can view information about an application without the need to dump a recording file or open up JDK Mission Control. This topic I pawned off to Billy. Expect a newscast on that in July. JDK 21 comes with a number of small additions to existing APIs. Let's quickly go over them so you're aware where the JDK can do your work for you. Character got a few static checks that let you identify emojis. First and foremost is emoji. Math got static clamp methods that take a value, a min and a max, and return a value that is forced into the min-max interval. It has four overloads for the four numerical primitives. String builder and string buffer got repeat methods, which allow you to add a character sequence or a code point multiple times to the string that is being built. String's index of methods got overloads that take a max index, and its new method split with delimiters behaves like split, but includes the delimiters in the returned array. The same split with delimiters was added to pattern, by the way. Need to shuffle a list in place? Then that's your reason to update to JDK 21. Once you did, you can pass the list and a random generator to collection shuffle, and it shuffles the list. an HTTP client can now be instructed to close, to shut down, and to await termination. But those are best effort implementations that can have adverse interactions with open request or response body streams. Locale.availableLocales returns a stream of all available locales. And because you've all asked for case-folded IETF BCP47 language tags, don't act like you didn't, Locale got the method case-fold language tag. As usual, there are links to all of this in the description. Windows 10 is the last 32-bit Windows, and it reaches end of life in October 2025, and the Java port for 32-bit Windows isn't heavily maintained anymore. For example, its implementation of virtual threads isn't virtual at all, they fall back to platform threads. So I guess it was to be expected that the port gets deprecated for removal, which JDK 21 does. And that's it for today on the Inside Java Newscast. Thank you for watching, I hope you liked it. If so, please let YouTube know and share this video with your friends and colleagues. I'll see you again in 2 weeks, but with some bad news, I'm afraid. So long.